I couldn't sit and shut up, it's not my nature. Mary, thank you for an excellent presentation. I guess I look after all arenas as an association in the province of Ontario, so we've been dealing with this for a long time. I was also on the IJC study board for the first study with the St. Clair River in Lake Ontario. I spent 5 years on that, $20 million. Was on the last one at the Upper Great Lakes study, and spent 3 years at that, $17 or $20 million. I guess the message I want to leave with you is three things. I think, and I don't know, I wish I did. I wish I knew what was happening with, global warming. I wish I knew what was happening with the polar ice caps. I wish I knew what was happening with the droughts and the tsunamis around the world and all those other things that are impacting all of this. I don't know that. But again, I wish I did. I wish I knew that the solution was plug up the St. Clair River. But I don't. But I think what, over these last 10 years, I have learned is that things have changed. And in fact, today, and I'm old and decrepit and have been on Georgian Bay for a long time, we have never had water levels at this level. Never. And that's a fact. And that, I'm sure Mary will tell you much more informed than I, that we had them in 36, we had them in 64, but they're now at the lowest level ever. We do have global warming. We know that. Doesn't sound like much, it's only 2 degrees, but it's phenomenal the impact that it's had. So I think my message today is I do not think that we can any longer accept the notion that the IJC has put forward that this is a situation that historically is going to do that. It's been down too low now. I think we have to take some more radical steps rather than sit back and wait for that trend to come back. And I guess if there's a message that I would like to see people provide all the information that we can, it's three things. On a selfish basis and for the marina operators that I work with, we have a crisis now. We had a crisis in 2000. In 1999 and 2000, the water level in Georgian Bay dropped at the most rapid precipitation rate in the history of keeping records. It dropped over a meter. At that time, the government of the day said, we will help do some dredging for you. Dredging has a very mixed connotation. Sometimes when you hear the word dredging, it's like, oh, Jesus, you don't want to do that. It's a short-term solution. It's not a long-term solution. It may be a way of allowing the marinas to continue, of getting some of the 72% of the people that belong to the Georgian Bay Association access their cottages by boat. It may be a way of giving them that. So we have a three-pronged approach to this. I think the very most important thing is we can no longer do nothing. I hope Mary's solution is right, and I hope that we get the money quickly and that it proves to be the right thing. But the bottom line is we need to do something, and do nothing is not acceptable anymore. And I think common sense, looking at the facts, is right. We need a crisis situation for dredging on a selfish basis for our marina members. Some of them are now faced with situations where they lay off their staff to help get money to pay for the dredging. And that's already happening where they can get permits. And the third issue is we need someone who understands the economics of the whole industry and who can play a very delicate balancing act of getting the politicians, the bureaucrats, in a position where we can deal with the issuance of permits and we can consolidate all of these 7 or 10 various levels of government and departments and pull it together and expedite getting this done. On one of the occasions that I was involved in, it's great working with the Americans, you know. They know everything. You go into the thing and they say, now, you sit back, you don't say anything. Listen, now let me tell you how this is going to work out. Okay, good. Would you do that? He says, we're in Michigan, and we know how to deal with these things. If some businessman bought a marina in Michigan and it doesn't have enough water, he was stupid. I said, well, that's fair. And I'm having a fit because I'm saying, oh, geez, our guys bought the marina, but they had water. Wait, now it's gone. No, he says, we've got a plan. And I said, well, look, that's, what is the plan? Well, he said, we know where every marina in Michigan is. And we know when the water goes down, how many slips it's going to use. And you know what we're going to do about it? We're going to close those damn things because it was his fault. And I went, oh my God. You know who the first person to come to the table with just a month ago? The state of Michigan has pumped in something like $15 million to help the marinas in their current source of problems. And the governor has found some money and he's made it available. So much for we know how to deal with this. The bottom line is, from our perspective, there is a crisis. We need some assistance. We need the bureaucrats to understand there's a crisis and to work with us on that. But the really important long-term one for, I think, people here, I've been in Georgian Bay, have been up here for a long, long time as a cottager and now the last 15 years as a permanent resident. Long-term, we can't accept an IJC that says this is just a partial thing and it'll come back, so go away and wait.
Would look at the lakes and nature, that they are sacred and they serve, they keep us alive and we need to serve them. There are a lot of interest around the world now in making our human laws more compatible with the laws of nature. What would happen, for instance, if British Petroleum could be sued by the Gulf of Mexico? I mean, just imagine, or the Athabasca River could claim damages from the energy industry up in the tar sands, or the lakes, the rivers and lakes around Chemical Valley and Sarnia and the area could claim their rights. This is not so far-fetched. There are countries in the world that have adopted the right to a healthy environment as part of their constitution. There are actually many countries in the world that are now including environmental rights in their constitutions, along with the notion of human rights. There's a lovely man named Cormac Cullinan who's written a book called Wild Law. He's a lawyer from South Africa. And he says that one day in the future, people will look back on our generation and they'll say, the way they treated the environment and other species is comparable to slavery, and that the way our generation looks back on former generations and sees you know, this terrible thing called slavery, cannot imagine how it could have existed and been lawful. People in future generations will not understand how we were able to not care for the wild, the wilderness and the nature around us. So under a commons regime, all activity, public and private, would come under strict public oversight and accountability. And it would operate within a mandate whose goals are the restoration and preservation of the waters of the basin, as well as water justice for all who live around it. And what we think we need, all of those of us living on or near these Great Lakes, in these many political jurisdictions, is a cohesive and common analysis of the crisis facing the lakes, a common narrative to guide us through this journey, and a common set of goals to unite us as we move forward. We also think we need basin-wide consistent laws, regulations, and definitions to protect and expand the existing public trust laws, and we have to demand eventually the supremacy of this framework over the current failing one. And when people say to me, well, you know, how would this work? Well, I can say to you that in Europe in 2000, they made an agreement to govern their watersheds on a watershed basis because all their watersheds crossed many political boundaries. And they realized they were not protecting their waters. And so they have governance models that see these watersheds as a you know, one basin that needs to have one governance, one set of laws and practices governing them. So I dream of a Great Lakes Basin Common Watershed Plan that encompasses watershed-wide planning and management, where we could come to common rules on toxic dumping, sewage waste, sustainable food production, groundwater mapping and protection, common plans to fight invasive species. And I think we need basin-wide bans on bunker oil, nuclear shipments, tar sands pipelines, fracking, water exports, including for bottled water, and ocean-going vessel access to the Great Lakes until these vessels can prove themselves to be safe in terms of their delivery or non-delivery of invasive species. Now, this would need the full cooperation, eventually, of all the jurisdictions around the lakes. And so people will say to me, you're dreaming in technicolor. But there's a thing called NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement. There's another called the Canada-US Border Security Agreement. We gave up tremendous amounts of sovereignty in these agreements. In NAFTA, we lost control of our energy. That's why they're in the tar sands, because we've used up all our conventional oil and gas. It's all exported, and now we're having to go to the poisonous stuff to keep up with our NAFTA commitments, to keep that energy flowing south. If we can give up sovereignty for, you know, the business community, surely we can come together and put the needs of the Great Lakes Basin together for us all. Surely we can come to some common agreement to save the Great Lakes of North America. I felt this on the tour. We've had a fabulous tour and a fabulous different events in every city. This is just phase one of this campaign, but what we're feeling from people is that they deeply care. They really want to do something and aren't sure how to do it. They'll say, I'm not a professional scientist, I'm not an environmental group, I don't know what to do. And our statement is, if you care at all, you have every right. You have what we call the right to care, and you have further the responsibility to care and to take the next steps. We would love to see this as a full treaty one day, and Jim Olson, who's a wonderful public trust lawyer from Traverse City, Michigan, and I presented to the International Joint Commission in December, and we presented this notion, and I think we got some very good feedback from them at the time, and we have just found out that the Waterkeepers Alliance, which is the alliance of all the waterkeepers, baykeepers, riverkeepers, and so on, at a meeting in the United States, chaired by Senator or Robert Kennedy Jr., came together and adopted this notion of the Great Lakes as a public trust and a commons, and are presenting this to the International Joint Commission. So this is an idea that people are excited about and feel they could come together on. What we're saying is, you may be fighting, a dam here, or a nuclear shipment here, or an invasive species here, or whatever, or a pollution there. But what are we doing together? Can we come together and see that this is all one fight, and that we have to have one common dream to protect these lakes, so that these aren't just separate fights, but part of a wonderful whole? Our starting point, however, is not with politicians. It's in the cities, towns, villages, hamlets, and farms that ring the Great Lakes, and the people who live on them and love them. And for us in Ontario, we have a wonderful opportunity coming up, and that's the pledge by the McGuinty government to hold public hearings on a new Great Lakes Protection Act. And we want that act to have vision, we want it to have soul, we want it to have depth, we want it to have
spirit.
We want it to be stronger, and we think this is something that we can come together on. And we're also hoping that people are going to start going to their local municipalities, and just like municipalities call themselves a blue community, they can call themselves community supporting the Great Lakes as a commons, a public trust, and a protected bioregion. So the purpose of this tour is to get communities around the lakes, as well as community and environmental groups that are already working on this, to come together through this narrative of the commons and strengthen people's cultural and visceral connections to the Great Lakes and promote this right to care. We need to build on the great work of countless national, state, provincial, community, First Nations groups that have toiled for decades to protect this jewel in our continent. We must commit to forge together a participatory process commensurate with the challenges of these mighty lakes and the communities, First Nations, and habitat that depend on them for life. The Great Lakes need great friends. In the end, we're their only hope. Thank you so much.
That'll be a meeting where the Mayor's Coalition will be providing information where we are in the process. We're not going to let this go. We're kind of like a dog with a bone now. As I said off the top, we went to Ottawa in October. The message was quite clear that they just didn't get it. Well, we're not letting them off the hook, ladies and gentlemen. And you know how you can get involved? You can sign Mary's petition, you can get behind her, you can send us the information that we need, because at the end of the day, it's always been proven that when the people talk and there's one unified voice, things can happen.